Our subject this morning is God's guidebook based on people should be educated to search the scriptures. Naturally, we don't know how. You need to learn. Lord, teach us to pray, Luke 11, verse 2. You got to have the Holy Ghost, Luke 12, 12, taught by the Holy Spirit. You know, John 6, 45, this should be taught of God. So rein your mind up and get it on the subject this morning. Don't be thinking about what you're going to have for lunch. To dare to think for themselves, teaching people how to think for themselves. Danger, men what? Thinking. Bible as their guidebook, our subject, part one, God's guidebook. Our subject this morning is also known as junk food or overfed and undernourished. Empty calories, we would say in the class. Now, when you read this, you can't get hold of this unless you, first lesson in studying the Bible, back up 10 verses, because you read verse 14 and it changes this. You got to read the whole thing, get the whole context. We're going to spend hours on that later. Who'll read Matthew 7:24? And I'll read verse 14.
Therefore, whosoever heareth these things of mine and doeth them, I will liken him unto a wise man, which built his house upon a rock.
Verse 14, straight is the gate and narrow is the way. Not many visitors in a neighborhood like that, right? Not many visitors. But those that come are serious, right? They want to listen. Isn't that true?
Yeah.
Now, here's the call, right? Come out of the junk food junkie shop. Come into what? Ho, everyone that thirsteth, come ye to the waters, and he that hath no money, don't worry. Food's cheap here. What's the cost? And in a sense, nothing. In a sense, Matthew 13, verse 46, when we find the one pearl of great price, he sold what? It cost you everything.
You have to count the cost.
You got to count the cost. Now you're building it up, right? You're going to build us a fortress of truth here. This is good. And he that hath no money, come, ye buy and eat, ye come, buy wine and milk without money and without price. Now, the problem with white bread, you eat 15 pieces, it still leaves you how?
Hungry.
Leaves you empty. Leaves you, you know, no fiber. Fiber deficient. Who read verse 2?
Wherefore do you spend money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which satisfies not? Hearken diligently unto me, and eat ye that which is good, and let your soul delight itself in fatness.
Now, question, is the bread from heaven, is that good for the body or the soul?
Both.
The belly or the mind?
Both.
Now, it's true, it has conditions, but it's got the big condition. You can't have it unless you first what choose to eat it. All right, comes with the condition. You got to eat it. All right, narrow gate, Matthew 7:14. Now, if you're too far to the right, you're called a formalist. Too far to the left, a fanatic. In Washington, too far to the left, a liberal, too far to the right, a conservative. Different names, now we bring it into the church. Over here, you got the fanatic and the extremist. Over here, the anything goes and the formalist. In the middle, and nobody in the middle, except Jesus, right? Where does it say that? Isaiah 30:21. Who read?
How straight is the gate, and narrow is the way which leadeth unto life, and few there be that find it.
So if you don't find it, you're building on the sand. Isaiah 30:21, you hear a word behind you saying what? This is the way, and if you do what?
Turn to the left or to the right.
That's right. Either ditch. You miss the gate. It's narrow, it's straight, and it's not for the fanatic, the flake, the formalist, or the anything goes. Now, somebody define formalist. Let's see who can be simple when you define it. I mean simple. I think I'm going to beat you on this one. You got it on the outside. The inside, you're dead, right? Yeah, thank you. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 5, having the form of godliness, but denying there's no inward power. It's all on the outside. From such what? Turn away. So a formalist. I know this is going to be a long class. This is why I'm going kind of fast at the beginning. By the way, when it comes to being a fanatic, it could be health, it could be prophecy, it could be definitions like sanctification. It could be on anything, right? Anything. The way you dress, it could be anything. Anything, right? Anything. So who'll read?
When the enemy sees that the Lord is blessing his people and preparing them to discern his delusions,
He will work with his masterly power to bring in fanaticism on one hand and cold formalism on the other, that he may gather in a harvest of souls. Now is the time to watch unceasingly. Watch for the first step of advance that Satan may make among us.
Devil's got on his kicking boots. He doesn't care which ditch he kicks you into. Because either ditch, you missed the narrow, straight gate. Isn't that true? Which is worse, a roaring fanatic or a meek formalist? I don't know. I'm not sure. I don't know. It's like, which is worse, being knifed to death or shot to death? Oh, well, I don't have to think about it. I can go back one. Yeah, formalist. You got to be careful. Watch for the first move, the first movement. It's usually a slow step. You go over into the ditch inch by inch, or as Arian would say, centimeter by centimeter. You don't go in there all at once overnight. For which of you intending to build the tower? Now, what you said, Ryan, you were five steps ahead of me. Sitteth not down first and counteth the cost, whether he have sufficient to finish it. Okay, let me see. The car's going to cost $10,000. I got 44 cents. What do you think?
You're out of luck.
I'm out of luck. Lest happily after this, but this is talking about spiritual things, right? It's not talking about building up a house you're going to live in. You know. Lest happily after he hath laid the foundations and is not able to finish it, all that behold it begin. Look at that turkey. Saying, this man began to build and was not able to finish. Or what king, going to make war against another king, sitteth not down first and consulteth whether he be able with 10,000 to meet him that cometh against him with 20,000? Or else, while the other is yet a great way off, he sendeth an embassage and desires conditions of peace. Now, before somebody reads the yellow, is it true the price of being a wholehearted Christian is your whole heart?
Yeah.
Count the cost before you choose. Yeah, go ahead and read the last part now.
So likewise, whosoever he be of you that forsaketh not all that he hath, he cannot be my disciple. And whosoever doth not bear his cross and come after me cannot be my disciple.
What's it going to cost you? Your whole? Heart. 23:26 of Proverbs, my son, give me your heart. To be a, I'm sorry, go ahead. No.
I'm sorry, is that the right reference, 14:27?
34. Probably 34, sorry about that. Yeah, racing through the racing this morning, I'm sorry. Yeah, thank you. I'm sure that should be 34. Yeah, it's 34. How did I put 27 on there?
No, I think you're right. Yeah.
That's 27.
Mm-hmm.
That's what, okay.
I think you just made it so you could.
Okay, that's 27. It is right.
It is 27.
It is 27. But you know, anything could go wrong.
It is 27?
Yeah.
Jesus gave everything, so I mean, it's a good transaction, I guess.
Yeah.
It's a fair transaction.
Matthew 24:16. Deny yourself, pick up your cross, follow me. Because what does it profit a man if he gain and lose his? So it's easy to reason it, hard to live it, right? Costs you your whole heart. Now, if you want to be a wholehearted Christian, you got to eat spiritual whole grain bread. True or false? Our subject this morning, cotton candy. It will fill your belly, but it will empty your soul. Now, can you turn the Bible into marshmallow treats?
Yes.
Yeah. Now, my definition of processed food, you add or take away, right? You processed it. You can add, let's take corn, you put butter on it, you just process it, right? You got wheat, you take away the fiber and the germ, you just processed it. Adding or take away processes and refines food. Is that okay to say that? So now, movie soundtracks. Do soundtracks in movies change your perception of what you see? Does it have an influence on your mind? Okay. Does it influence what you're watching? Yeah. Now, I want to play for you. Yeah, this is about the most, I'm going to use a big word, sorry. I'm going to pull out a big word, innocuous. So it's kind of like, yeah, it's like, I want to play the same thing with the soundtrack and without it.
Disarmed.
It's 45 seconds long. Yeah.
Yeah.
Wait a minute, I meant... I think.
Yeah, that's.
Oh, it is Batman.
can't stay awake. Got away, didn't they? They got away, didn't they? Uh-oh. Bad news for them. And enough of that. Now, with the soundtrack. It's the batarang. What happened? It must have been Batman. Today the devil's taking a new angle, right? He's putting soundtracks on Bibles in Mrs. White's books. Mm-hmm. Tells you they're dramatized. When you read Mark 4:39, peace be still, and you hear the storm, that is not the storm. That is invented in a sound studio. When you see John 8 and a woman caught in adultery, that is not her voice as you hear that woman say, no man, Lord. It is when Jesus is speaking on Calvary, that is not Jesus speaking. That is dramatized. And it changes your perception. It affects what you see, hear, taste, and touch. That's making white bread out of the Bible. The Bible closes saying, don't make white bread out of my guidebook, right? These aren't the last verses. It's almost the last verses. So I'd like to read. He'll tell you, right? You can read it, right? It says dramatized, right? Dramatized. It is people playing roles as they go through the Bible. The Lord designed that Bible, that book would lay there, and when you read it, nobody speaks but the Holy Ghost. You read that thing and God interprets it to your heart. I guess, right? We'd like to read.
For I testify unto every man that heareth the words of the prophecy of this book. If any man shall add unto these things, God shall add unto him the plagues that are written in this book.
And that's old. Proverbs 30:6, add not unto his words. That's all over the Bible. Now, the devil wants to discredit the Bible. True? Of course he does. First step, add or take away from it. Process it. Make it into white bread. And if any man shall take away, right? That's if you add. Now, if you add, God adds the plagues. You take away, he takes your name out of the book of life. This is an eternal life issue. I'll read Revelation. Somebody else can read Acts 23. And if any man shall take away from the words of the book of this prophecy, God shall take away his part out of the book of life and out of the holy city and from the things which are written in the books. Now, before you read the bottom, the Pharisees were in one ditch. Finish the sentence.
The Sadducees were in another.
The other. Yeah. They had completely diverse views. The devil said, that's okay. Who'll read?
For the Sadducees say that there is no resurrection, neither angel nor spirit. But the Pharisees confess both.
Yeah. Doesn't matter. Which ditch are you in? Doesn't matter. Eat 14 meals a day? Eat one meal a day. You in a ditch? You're in a ditch. How are we going to get out? Luke 23. My favorite chapter in the Bible this morning. This is when Jesus, this is the chapter when he's giving it to the thief, right? Dying on Calvary chapter. Who'd like to read? Luke 23, verse 12.
That very day, Pilate and Herod became friends with each other. For previously, they had been at enmity with each other.
Yeah, that's what I call unity in the ditches. But the Pharisee and the Sadducee had a meeting of the minds. What did they meet on? We're going to kill that man, right? In the end, history repeats itself. Isn't that wonderful? I met Darlene. She was as nutty as a fruitcake. And so was
you.
Thank you. But she was nutty in that direction. She believed everything. I believed nothing. That's okay. It doesn't care which ditch you're in, does he? Now, this is an interesting little statement. So as the priests, the rulers, and the elders gathered for consultation, it was their fixed determination. Yeah, finish the sentence for me. Birds of a feather? Yeah, that's it. Now, I don't know what Darlene's been showing you on those Sunday morning videos, but these CAFOs, these large industrialized farms to raise chickens, is that an incubator for viruses in this, and leads to what, the great pandemics and all this, right? Yeah. Here's the incubator. Who read?
So, as the priests, the rulers, and the elders gathered for consultation, it was their fixed determination to silence him who did such marvelous works that all men wondered. Pharisees and Sadducees were more nearly united than ever before. Divided hitherto, they became one in their opposition to Christ.
I'm trying to avoid the next pandemic, aren't you?
Yeah.
Now, how do you avoid the next spiritual pandemic? Easy. You get God's guidebook. You just follow it. Yeah, that's it. So why don't we try it? Let's try it now. But let's apply what we just learned. Let's apply what we're learning. Is that okay? Mm-hmm. Who is that?
That's
Darlene. Can I say it?
She wasn't lying. She wasn't lying.
All stages, right? All stages. I made Darlene a birthday card. And I made that, and I told her. So I blacked out the bottom. I got a little block over it. That was sweet talk to my wife. That was a birthday card I made for her. Did she like it? Yeah, because pictures bring back good. Okay, that's all right. It's okay to have pictures. What's so funny in there? Which one is it? So I'll take one, and I'll tell you why it really brings back a good memory for me. That one. See, that's on the left. There's the whole picture, because I had to cut it up to put it in there. You see there's no insulation on the walls. Some of the drawers aren't even built yet. We moved into my house before it was finished because we were staying with a ton of people in Sunshine. We had guests in the bottom, where you live, Ryan. We had guests in the bottom, two bedrooms, two guests. On the next floor, we had four families. Darlene and I were in the attic. That's where I stayed for 2 years. You think it's hot up there? I lived there 2 years. You complain about cooking? For 12 years, Darlene and I did all the cooking here. So you don't tell me anything about cooking. And I washed all the dishes every meal, every day. So I've had some work in the kitchen. Don't see you there now much. Well, you don't see me there a whole lot, no. But look on the bridge. So there it is. I look at that picture, that's nice. Didn't have any insulation, just got electricity. Got some running water over there, the sink started working. Darlene's making bread. That picture is probably, you know, I don't know, 15 years old, 16, 17 years old. Is that okay to look at that picture and get a good memory? Mm-hmm. Is that balanced to do that? Mm-hmm. Is that okay?
Sure.
Okay. A few in blank. A few in, you fill in place. It goes so far as to burn all their pictures. Is that a problem? Mm-hmm. And Mrs. White will tell you why. Someone like to read? Finish the sentence for me. I've burned all my pictures. Now you need to burn yours. That will tell you you are in the ditch. When you want other people to do what you do, I drink soy milk, you ought to drink what? I drink cow's milk, you ought to drink what? I dress this way, you ought to dress what? This way. When you want others to do what you do, you know you are a certified five-star fanatic. Now, you might hear me say, I ought to do what Jesus did. But I give you 13:15 of John. I've given you an example. You should do as I have done. He said that, not me. Philippians 2:5, let this mind be in you. Think like he thinks, act like he acts, walk like he walks. That's okay. But he wasn't a fanatic. He was perfectly balanced. And if you were to say, do what I do, and you're as balanced as Christ, then I'd say, tell me more. But there aren't any. There's not one. Mm-hmm. There's just not one around. I haven't met one yet, have you? You know you're a fanatic. Now, let me tell you, that's a five-star. You know when you become a 10-star fanatic? when you get a reference from Mrs. White, mail it to somebody and say, this is what God said. Yeah. Where'd I come up with all that? Let me give you the Bible verse, Mark 4, verse 23. If any man hath ears to hear, then what? Let him hear. We have ears, but we don't hear. When you make the Bible your food, your meat, and your drink, are you, I supposed to eat the guidebook? Yes. Eat the book. You will know better how to receive counsel from God. I exalt the precious word before. Now, you just got to read this one carefully. I exalt the precious word before you today. Do not repeat what I have said, saying, Sister White said this, Sister White said that. Never do that. Now you got to read the rest. Don't stop there. I don't have to read those now. Find out what the Lord God of Israel says, and then do what He commands. And I put the bottom, from an address to church leaders the night before the opening of the General Conference session 1901, the Great Reorganization General Conference. Don't say Sister White said this, Sister White said that. Find out what the Lord God of Israel says, and then do what He commands. Now, you also would agree, right? The faith in the last prophet tells you your faith in the first prophet. The way you treat this one is the way you would treat that one if that one were living with this one. True?
You gotta receive it.
Yeah. Yeah. But you say you love Moses, but you hate me, you're a bold-faced liar. Because what Moses said are the words that testify to me. So you put it with this. Lay Sister White right to one side. Lay her to one side. Don't you ever quote my words again as long as you live. Now, I will tell you the problem if you don't see this. If you say King David said, you missed it. God said it when He spoke in the Psalms that David wrote. David didn't say it. God did. Mrs. White said, no, Mrs. White didn't say it. God did. This is the problem when you start quoting and attribute it to men. It's not what men say. Men never said it. If they did, then it's the words of man. And when you have obedience to what God said, it gives you evidence that how you relate to the prophets.
She actually said there would have been no need for her. Right?
No need. No need for the Bible if we've taken the Ten Commandments. Right. No need for the Ten Commandments. The angels didn't hardly know it, right? It was there, but you had to bring it to the front when the devil got, you know. Don't you ever quote my words again as long as you live until you can obey the Bible. When you take the Bible and make that your food and your meat and your drink and make that the elements of your character, when you can do that, you will know better how to receive some counsel from God. Here is the word, the precious word exalted before you today. Don't you give a rap anymore what Sister White said. Sister White said this, Sister White said that, Sister White said the other thing. But say, thus saith the Lord God of Israel, right? Desire of ages, thus saith the Lord. Yeah. When you want to dispel darkness, emit light. Who said that? The Lord. The Lord God of Israel does in what He says. Now, if anybody have a Bible, Amos chapter... you can do it for me. But Amos 4. Amos 4. Somebody wants to do it. Everything we've just read is in 50 chapters. We'll use Amos 4. Okay? Amos 4. You already got it? Okay? All right. Now I'll ask her to read certain parts. Amos chapter 4, verse 3.
And ye shall go out at the breaches, every cow at that which is before her, and ye shall cast them into the palace, saith the Lord.
What's this last part?
Saith the Lord.
Verse 5, please.
Mm-hmm. And offer a sacrifice of thanksgiving with leaven, and proclaim and publish the free offerings, for this liketh you, O ye children of Israel, saith the Lord God.
Verse 6, please.
And I also have given you cleanness of teeth in all your cities, and want of bread in all your places, yet ye have not returned unto me, saith the Lord.
How about 8, 9, 10, and 11?
All of them.
All of them. Amos wrote, he did not. Amos wrote that he did not. Yeah, that's That's when you stay safe. Now, pointer number two for this thing coming up on the interview thing. Number one, best way to dispel darkness is to emit light. Number two, use what the Lord said, not what you said, because when the Lord said it, you got authority, right? He said, God is no respecter of persons. I got time. Number three, Revelation 12, verse 11. 12, verse 11. They overcame by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. And the love lies not until even death. But look, you notice, you don't talk about what the devil did to you. You overcame by the what? Blood of the Lamb. You talk about what God's done for you, not what the devil's done to you. Yeah. And today you go to CNN and look what they're doing to me. They'll never reach your heart because you're not, thus saith the Lord. You're not following. You don't have the guidebook. You blame others. You feel sorry for yourself. Write them down the list. Well, let's take that video and hit delete before we even start. Dispel darkness, admit light. Dear friends, you got better than you ever deserved. Isn't that true? Mm-hmm. So, thus saith the Lord, Ephesians 2:8. Okay, who read the bottom? Obedience is what? Better than sacrifice. So, if we can abide by the pointers, if we can abide by the guidebook, we'll get to heaven. Now, this is out of Mrs. White's diary. Right, well, the diary. Now, before we read this, the great challenge with a man, I don't care how smart he is or how long he's lived, is to try to unlearn all that foolishness we have put into our minds. Whew, tell you what,
no,
I just think.
Have to do it in the shortest pieces.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, you don't have 40 years like Moses. God go easy on Moses, but you, right? So who will read manuscript 22, 1890? Who will read?
Why will not men see and live the truth? Many study the scriptures for the purpose of proving their own ideas to be correct. They change the meaning of God's word to suit their own opinions. And thus they do also with the testimonies that he sends. They quote half a sentence and leave out the other half, which, if quoted, would show their reasoning to be false. God has a controversy with those who wrest the scriptures, making them conform to their preconceived ideas.
That's it. All the time.
To their own destruction.
All the time. I listen to people all the time trying to justify what they're doing. Everything from having three wives to they got some kind of verse. The Sabbath nailed it across. Some kind of verse. Now, to make it more personal, when Darlene became a Seventh-day Adventist, she told me John the Baptist was Elijah reincarnated, based on Mark 9 and Matthew 17. Darlene believed reincarnation. It was hard to empty her mind of that. If you go, and I did, this is what I did, I said, Darlene, John the Baptist is who? Elijah. I said, John 1, verse 21. Are you Elijah? Are you that prophet? He said, I am not. She snapped out of it.
Light.
Yeah, light. Now, you didn't need to attack anything about what all the spiritualists were saying. Boom, light.
We have to make a decision when you're confronted.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
What are you going to regress or...
Yeah, let's say somebody's in a room, just black, dank, darkness, right? Darkness, just darkness, darkness. You take a little flashlight, you put it in the window, dark outside, everything's dark, flashlight, pip, you turn it on, little light, boom. Friends, if they come to the light, and I'm borrowing John 1, 4 into the places, they come to the light, you know they have an interest. But when they turn the light on, they say, hey, shut that thing off! They're not interested. Just a little light, boom. Can you name some people in the Bible? Jesus gave us a little flashlight, boom.
The rich young ruler.
He saw it, he was drawn to a point, right? I can think of 50. Nicodemus. He just gave us a little bit, boom. Woman at the well, boom. And they came. Some came fast, some came slow. But they came. Fruit, we would especially, and I want to use another example. Is it good to eat fruit in its natural state. Would you rather eat a mango cooked or raw? Of course, me too. I mean, you want to cook it, that's okay, but I'd rather have mine raw. But if I got 10,000 mangoes out there in the sun, I can't eat them all. How? You can cook it, or you can dry it, or you can can it, you can freeze it, you can do a lot of things. Let's say I'm going to can it. Because back in Mrs. White's day, you couldn't freeze it. So you did what in her day? You canned it. Fruit we would especially recommend as a health-giving agency. It would be well for us to do less cooking and to eat more fruit in its natural state. Let us teach the people to eat freely of the fresh grapes, apples, peaches, pears, berries, and other kinds of fruit that can be obtained. And if you stop right there, and that's the argument that people say, raw foods. This is what they use. Where is the next sentence? They try to find something, cut it apart, do surgery, and no. It says, but you got all this fruit, you want to eat it in winter, what do? Now, as far as canning, some of you have preserved and canned, right? Mm-hmm. Do you have to cook it before you can it? Yeah, sure. Yeah, it's implied in it, you cook it. There is nowhere in Mrs. White's writings anywhere that says eat raw foods. Now, should you eat raw foods? Yeah, a lot of raw foods are good. So somebody asked me one time, it was a person that was a patient here, I'm going on a raw foods diet. So what are you going to eat? She said oranges. I said, that's wonderful. I'm going to eat this. Wonderful, 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 wonderful. It's all wonderful. It's wonderful. I said, what about a sweet potato? Can't eat that. What about oats? Can't eat that. What about wheat? Can't eat that. What about bread? Can't eat that. What about rice? Can't eat that. Well, okay. That's not so wonderful. Because you go down to the beans and rice people in Guatemala and you say, you can't eat that. And they'll run you out of there. Because you are in the ditch. Raw foods are great. Raw foods are great. But so are cooked foods. Thus saith the Lord. Yeah, fruit. Yeah, eat fruit raw. I mean, eat salads raw. Raw, great. Oranges, wonderful. Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. And she says, can't eat that. And I said, why? Living enzymes. Give me some science on that. PubMed.gov living enzymes didn't say anything. And give me some proof. Give me some evidence. Enzymes. And all the rest. And I'm not going to say anything else but alkaline and acid balance and all these things. It just stirs up controversy. Run from controversy. Run from controversy. Dispel darkness, admit light. Run from controversy. I won't eat peaches in December, don't you? Yeah. You better cook it.
But it's so easy. Why is it so easy to be lured into these things?
I don't know. Why is it so easy to go into the ditch? I don't know. But everybody's in it. I mean, everybody's in it. I heard Elder Frazee, kind of like my dad, one time he said it. He said, balanced men, now the ones walking with Christ, where are they? He said, God may finally get a man balanced up, finally. And then he dies of old age.
You know, talking about the ditch, it's easier to go in the ditch than it is to work to stay out of it.
It's easy to go in, hard to come out. And once you come out, hard to stay out. Because it's a narrow way. It's easy to take. Anybody ever had a can of Big Franks? Wham, come on, admit it. Come on, admit it. Don't say, oh, I'm not going to eat that. Wham, Big Franks, Vigilinx. What's the what those other things?
Spam.
Yeah, let's take Mrs. White and turn it into Big Franks here. How are we going to do it? I'm talking about fake hot dogs.
Oh, those gross greens. I've never seen
I was at a store, I can't say where, in a health food store. I was working at this institution, went down to help out. My job wasn't the health food store, I was helping out once, stocking the shelves between a program, and needed some exercise. And boy, you those Big Franks, you got to put them out by the case, because they go just like this. They go like this.
Is it like the Vienna sausage thing?
It's got hot dogs. Oh. It's hot dogs.
Veggie
dogs. Many excuse. Admit light now. Admit light. Look, if you go on to, if you do some kind of thing, and people at Loma Linda Foods see that, what do they call that? Dog food? No. Admit light. So many excuse their disregard of the testimonies. There it is, by saying, here it is. What do they say? Go ahead.
By her husband, the testimonies are molded by his spirit and judgment. Others are seeking to gain something from me which they can steward to justify their course or to give them influence.
Yeah, it's James White. James White had hypnotized her, brainwashed her. E.G. White, Big Franks. Add to or take away? I don't know if that's adding to or taking away. What is that, adding to or taking away? I'm not sure. James White. I don't know if it's an adding or taking away. Okay, we can slow down now. Now when I send you a testimony, by the way, God sent you one, didn't he? Because those books are written for our admonition, 1 Corinthians 10:11, upon whom the ends of the earth have come. These books are for me. Now when I send you a testimony, Galatians 2:20, Paul keeps saying, for me, for me, for me, for me, for me. Paul sounds like a broken record in Galatians. For me, for me, for me. I'm crucified there. Yeah, it's just for me. Now, when I send you a testimony of warning and reproof, many of you declare it to be merely the opinion of Sister White. Mm-hmm. You have thereby insulted the Spirit of God. You know how the Lord has manifested. I like this one. Watch what she's about to do. She's about to bring you Seventh-day Adventists to a decision. Either you're for me or you're against me. Do not waffle. You're either going into, yeah. You know how the Lord has manifested himself through the spirit of prophecy. Now, who read the rest of the paragraph?
Past, present, and future have passed before me. I have been shown faces that I have never seen, and years afterward I knew them when I saw them. I have been aroused from my sleep with a vivid sense of subjects previously presented to my mind, and I have written at midnight letters that gone across the continent, and arriving at a crisis, have saved great disaster to the cause of God. This has been my work for many years. A power has impelled me to reprove and rebuke wrongs that I have not that I had not thought of. Is this work of the last 36 years from above or from beneath?
Decide. Because what comes from heaven leads to. And if you said it came from hell, because you got to decide. It's either from heaven or it's not. Because if you say it's not from heaven, and she said it was, then she's a
liar.
And that makes her a false prophet. Mm. She brought herself to a place where you have to make a decision. Had not thought of, is this work of the last 36 years from above or from beneath? Now, we hear, but we don't do. And when you don't do, Laodicea, formalism / indifference. That's the problem with Luke Keith. Rank formalism, but without even having to form. That's double duty, right? The living truth of God is to be made known in all our medical insanity. And we'll end with this one. This is nice. Just take it slow. Yeah, this find some balance here. Your gym, you know, the guests that come and they go. Got two ladies coming in a few days. The living truth of God is to be made known in our medical institutions. Yeah, praise the Lord, right? This does not mean that the doctor or any of the workers are to introduce the truth to everyone. Mm-hmm. That's not the way to do it. The truth can be presented without doing this. The nurses and workers are not to go to the patient saying, we believe in the third angel's message. Do not say you believe in third angel's message to patients. Third angel's message includes what distinctive doctrines?
Health reform.
Health reform is a big one.
Message.
Health message. Give me another.
Sanctuary.
Stay the dead. Second coming. Spirit prophecy, you know, it's all these things. Don't bring it up. Don't say it. That is not their work. Unless what?
Good desire to.
Yeah. And unless all their objections have been removed and their hearts have been softened. I'll give you just one example. If Miss Barbara does not mind me using her for an example. When I went to Wildwood, you said the same thing about coming here. I had the same experience when I went to Wildwood. I thought, what's it going to be like to go into that bin of flakes? I didn't know. And now he says, what's it going to be like? Yeah, I didn't know. And so I was, what's the word? I was something. Yeah. Guests are the same way when they come here. They read that stuff on the website. And it's like some of them say, it's like, yeah, got to be easy, right? Easy. And if you talk about the Sabbath and they're Catholic, you're pouring gas on a fire, but you built the fire to pour the gas on. You know? Ease off until their objections have been removed. Now, I'll tell you, it's really, let's say there's a lady, this covered with jewelry. And she comes to the class and sitting right there. I want to guess, I'm going to come to the class next day. I get here, she's here. The subject is jewelry. She's wearing jewelry. The subject is jewelry. What should I do?
Change the subject.
Thank you. Thank you. No, thank you. Change the subject.
Of course.
Want to talk about Luke 23. Lord, remember me when I'll come to thy kingdom. And that draws her. But the problem is, you got 9-10 people in the room, one with jewelry on. What's she going to think? It's all directed at her. But in the church, you got 60 people there. Jim was in the church last Sabbath. And I could say something about the Adventists have the truth. It's not like I'm saying he doesn't. He's a Lutheran. Yet the Lutherans don't have it. He's in a sea of faces. He doesn't take it personally. Thank you. But the patient, we're doing a lecture with a guest. You got one patient and you. They're going to take it how? Personally, aren't they? So easy does it on those things. Anything is going to drive somebody off. Easy does it. Yeah. Next paragraph. Act so that the patients will see the Seventh-day Adventists are people who have common sense. Common sense ain't what? Common. Got no sense. Left. He got no sense over there at Butler Creek. Why? Well, they're talking about Jesus being locked up in a box upstairs called a sanctuary. They don't know. The Baptists come in here. They say, what? You're not going to heaven until a long time after you die? Billy Graham's in heaven today. You can't knock out the first Bible study I had. Oh, God help me when I did that. The first Bible study in my life was with a guy named Roger. Darlene had grown up with him. He went to school with her. First time ever given a Bible study as a Seventh-day Adventist. I said, Roger, there's no such thing as the rapture. He got up and walked out and never talked to me again. I was in the ditch.
Yeah, you can present truth in a way that even though it's truth, you could be a stumbling block as well.
Yeah. With Roger, the last thing I should have been talking about that morning was what? The rapture. And the first thing I talked about was what? The rapture. Act so that they will feel that the institution is a restful place. Bible truth is to be presented, but special points of truth are not to be brought out before all the patients. If they ask you questions, give them the reasons of your faith. In this way, light will shine forth. Patients may be asked to attend our meetings, and there they will hear the truth, knowing at the same time it is not pressed upon them. You don't feel singled out. In fact, let's say, you work with a bunch of worldly people. Okay, you work with worldly people. And you carry your lunch. They're all going out to the Taco Bell or whatever, or the Benihana. You take your lunch every day. After a few weeks, aren't they going to wonder what you're eating in that falafel? falafel, what do you call it?
That actually happened with me.
Yeah, and after a while, what happens?
They start bringing their lunch.
I actually had the option to bring lunch for them. They would pay me.
Yeah.
My coworkers.
But you bring that kind of thing in every day. What do people say after a while?
They start questioning.
Well, Cordial, what you got there? What you doing? What are you eating that for? They may mock you, but did they see you? And after, what are you eating there every day? Well, I got hummus on some whole wheat bread. What's wrong with you?
Even the mocking after a while turns around.
Sure
it
does.
That's what they say. They'll start bringing it
true to your consistent.
You don't care what's saying.
I think it's Matthew, this is a guess, 23:44. They cast the same in his teeth, both thieves. But 23:42 and 43 of Luke, the thief had turned around. The mocking turned around. Yeah, mocking's just part of it. My sister, when we became an Adventist, she said, "You bring that bird food in here again?" And one time, Darlene made a tofu turkey. We put it beside a real turkey. And my sister came down the line, and she looked at both of them, and she looked at it, and didn't quite look like a turkey. Then she looked at me. I said, "Fake turkey." Did she mock? Yeah. At first.
Just for my brother, and he was the first one to come into the church. And I have five brothers, and we were all a close family. When he came into the church, talk about being mocked. I mean, they used to fall down underneath and call him holy man. Eventually, we were all.
Yeah. So that's part of the package. It comes with the territory. That's part of the deal, right? Little mocking. How you respond to the mocking will make or break the marriage. Ooh, back to marriage. Yeah, it will. Patients may ask to attend our meetings, and there they will near to be the truth. Now, when they say may be asked to attend, I always say, Jim, we're going to church. If you want to go, we'd love to have you. If you'd like to stay here, give some videos, da, da, da. Almost always they say what? Sure. Yeah, they want to go. They want to go. Patients may be asked to attend our meetings, and there they will hear the truth, knowing at the same time it is not pressed upon them. Then, when they leave the sanitarium, here it comes. When they leave the sanitarium, now Jim's gone home to Wisconsin, and hear people saying, I do not want here to be made a Seventh-day Adventist. We'll read the rest of it.
They will tell them that the workers at the sanitarium press the truth upon no one.
Amen. Keep going.
It will be impossible to keep patients from inquiring in regard to our faith. There are those who hunger and thirst for truth. And such ones will find it. That is why we want our institution established at once.
Yeah. Give them whole wheat bread. But they eat it by choice. And you want them to eat faster, what are you going to do? Ram it down their throats? Mm-hmm. Choke them. And this is insurance against formalism, fanaticism, unbalanced thinking, all those things. This is your insurance. You shall not add unto the word which I command you. Yeah, Revelation is back in Deuteronomy 4. Mm-hmm. Neither shall you diminish aught from it, that ye may keep the commandments of the Lord your God, which I command. The voice of the Lord speaking in his guidebook. This is going to keep us out of the ditch. Mm-hmm. I really don't want to go into the ditch. And I end with this. I'm done. But I got to. Do you believe God gives dreams? You ever had one, maybe? Maybe? I think I had one, I'll tell you. I had a concern about the way people were dressing. This is a long time ago. And I decided I would address everyone on the matter of modesty and dress. And so I had it all planned out, had what I was going to say, and then I went to bed. And before I woke up, I had a dream. And in the dream, I'm laying there, and I see all the people in the institution, maybe at the time there were like 17 people, all 17 people just walking around the yard. They're all wearing micro, mini short, hot pants. You know what hot pants are?
Yeah.
Yes, that's an old fashioned thing. Yeah, Leah doesn't know what they are. This is this old time. So tight shorts. And I looked around. Yeah, well, yeah, still wearing them, right? Still wearing. And I looked around. Yeah, I didn't know I was dreaming. I thought I was awake, right? Looked around. Oh, man, look at that. Look at that. Got to talk to these people. Yeah. I looked down. Guess what I was wearing? Guess what I was wearing? I canceled the meeting.
Yeah.
So,
I could have done
without. Yes, Lord. Straight at you. Get it.
Yeah. Now, you can't tell me that, but God can. And when God tells me that, and I say that came from Barbara, or that came from Renee, I just processed, that's the problem. Cancel the meeting.
Oh, gracious.
And I pray. All right. Father in heaven, you're gracious, you're merciful, you're good. We're out of balance. We're drowning in our own self-righteousness in the ditch. But we know who can get us out. There's a guidebook on how to escape the ditch and enter into heaven. I pray as we give study to this guidebook in the next 20 hours, you'll bless us with some understanding. I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Amen.